To discuss that more, we're joined by political commentator and analyst Jason Unruhe, who is joining us live from Ontario. Thank you very much, Mr. Unruhe. Now, Mr. Rouhani did not mince his words. He was very blunt, saying that if the U.S. seeks any kind of negotiations, or in his words also, again, a chance for a photo shoot with Donald Trump, if he is seeking that with Mr. Hassan Rouhani, he will need to lift the sanctions that he has imposed on Iran, sanctions that are illegal, and that U.S. reimposed them after it unilaterally left the nuclear deal. What is your take on this? And do you believe that Donald Trump is in a position where he would actually do that?
Well, I think that this is something that was definitely a long time coming. Iran has showed incredible patience in trying to deal with the current U.S. administration and the baseless allegations that they had violated the JCPOA agreement. There was nothing of the sort. Nobody believes them, not the regulatory bodies, not the European signatories, no one. Everybody knows that this was a lie and was designed in order to give justification for sabotaging the agreement. Now, when this situation first happened, Iran, it took a very strategic patience kind of position. Okay, we'll continue to play by the rules. We'll try to convince the United States to come back to the agreement so that everything can resume the way it was and everything will be relatively fine, just the way things were before all this started. But the United States has made perfectly clear that that's not going to happen in this case. What they want is a new deal with Iran, a new nuclear deal, one that's much harsher on Iran than the one that's currently in use right now. And the United States, of course, has demonstrated that they will go to any lengths. They will make up lies. They will outright break the law. They will violate the agreement. And then once having left the agreement, accuse Iran of having broken that agreement that they themselves had already violated, and again then accusing Iran with no evidence whatsoever. And then Iran took the next step, and that is to take measures that are granted to them by the agreement itself, which are very clearly written. It's right out there for anyone to see. And then the United States attacks them for doing that, and Iran progressed into further steps that they're legally obligated to take, and the United States has kiboshed everything right from the beginning, ready to destroy any kind of goodwill, destroy any kind of attempt at negotiation. So it's very clear that playing by the rules, you know, isn't going to work here. Trump is absolutely determined to ruin this agreement. Now, there's no reason that Iran should come to the table unless the illegal sanctions against them have been removed. Iran tried being patient. They tried giving Trump the benefit of the doubt that he might change his mind, but he certainly has not. And Trump, if was not willing to carry out his political function in this particular scenario within the confines of the law, then Iran is not obligated to follow an agreement that does not exist. And if the United States wants a new agreement, then they should withdraw the current sanctions and then allow a negotiation to take place, because there's no reason to put the sanctions on Iran as it is right now. And I think that Donald Trump perfectly well could. He could sign an order tomorrow ending these sanctions and then returning to dialogue. It could be done. But I don't think he's going to do that. This has not been the way that the United States has conducted business, or conducted, I should say, foreign relations under this administration. They have been nothing but, for the lack of a better term, bullies who have simply made demands of everyone else and accepted nothing, no kind of concession in return. Well, maybe that's how it works when he does business with his hotels and casinos, but that is not how international relations between countries operate. There are long-standing agreements that are mutually beneficial, some very simple economic phenomena such as comparative advantage, which allows both sides to gain something out of, you know, an organized economic trade. However, this seems to be something that Trump does not see. For him, it's his way or the highway. And that's the way that he's used to doing business. And thus far, the hawks inside of Washington, who seem to have his ear for the most part, seem to be in agreement with this kind of position towards people that they have declared to be enemies of the United States. This entire situation is the result of Donald Trump himself choosing to deal with things that the way that he has. And as I've said before, none of this had to happen. Things didn't have to be this way at all. They could have continued as they were in if not wholly peaceful, at least a stable situation, one that has not escalated into people sending warships into different areas of the world, claiming that this is about protecting their sovereignty, and then calling on the UK to do it, and then calling on Australia, calling on Israel to do it, which is essentially just going to create an entire mess where everybody's pointing guns at each other and everybody's ready to pull the trigger over the smallest little incident.
Mr. I'm very sorry to cut you off. It seems that the U.S. is quite isolated in the policy that has been taken, particularly regarding Iran. And on the other hand, we also do know that President Donald Trump now, he is beginning his campaign for the 2020 elections, and he is definitely resorting to populist policies. It was very intriguing for his fan base to see him in a photo with Kim Jong-un. Maybe he's just seeking a photo opportunity with President Hassan Rouhani just to say that he was able to solve the nuclear issue, an issue that he created himself, for people who don't really follow the news that strictly.
Oh, that certainly is the case, and you can say that of many of the people who do follow President Trump, who are very, very loyal to him. The ones that are particularly loyal to him, they don't intend to do very much in the way of research or understanding. They simply see the pictures, the 10-second sound bites, the brief messages from Donald Trump, and then from there they form their own conclusion, as Trump has already crafted it for them. And I think that you are very much right. The European signatories to the agreement are certainly fed up with this nonsense. Well, we saw Javad Zarif, the foreign minister, meet with Emmanuel Macron, essentially what is what people are saying is behind Trump's back, carrying out perhaps some kind of negotiation. Not exactly sure what it is that they talked about, but it's very obvious that this is about the JCPOA and the current standoff that's taking place in the Strait of Hormuz right now. And Germany has already said that they will not send any ships in to harass Iran in any way. So yes, other than the very typical partners, that being the UK and Israel, they're the only ones who seem to be siding with the United States. Everybody else seems to be getting quite fed up with the way that the United States has been doing business, because it's not just these kind of actions that are being taken against Iran, but it's also being done against China. It's also being done against India. It's being done against several Latin American countries, particularly Venezuela, even Germany itself. And many of these countries are very fed up with the way that the United States is acting and are forming particular power blocks, even kinds of payment systems that are beyond the reach of the United States to facilitate that kind of rejection of U.S. policy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jason Unruhe, political commentator and analyst, joining us live from Ontario.